Welcome to Worship with Messiah Online. We're glad you're with us today. Today we're going to have a special treat. Pastor Tim Ellington will be our guest preacher. Pastor Tim is one of the pastors at Aldersgate United Methodist Church in Irvine. We're glad to have him with us today. A couple announcements before we get into worship. Charity's Closet, a thrift shop in Placentia which supports his house, is looking for volunteers. If you're interested in that, please contact Linda Baker and she can get you connected. Our choir will be starting up again for the fall. They're going to begin rehearsing Thursdays at 7 p.m. starting September 8. The choir is led by Francisco Calvo and it sings Sundays at the 8:30 service. You can contact Francisco if you're interested in joining, or I suppose you could just show up at 7 o'clock on September 8 and begin singing with the choir. Also coming up soon, we have our fall kickoff, Back in the Saddle, on Saturday, September 10. This will be a picnic with a chili cook-off, country music, pony rides, and a bounce house. In addition to having all of that going on, we'll be welcoming back Pastor Bob and Jeannie from Pastor Bob's sabbatical. So please join us for that, and you can sign up online to let us know that you're coming. With that, we'll begin worship in the name of our Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now let's sing our gathering hymn.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Let's pray. Lord God, you are the Lord of all nations, the Lord of all the world. You reveal your will to the people, to your people. You promise us your help in living out the lives you mean for us to live. Help us to hear and do as you command, to live as your people, reflecting your light and love and resisting the darkness. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our scripture passage today is from Matthew chapter 7, beginning at the 24th verse. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. That's the end of the reading. And now we'll hear from Pastor Tim Ellington.
Hi, my name is Tim Ellington, and I am a pastor at Aldersgate United Methodist Church, which is in Tustin. And I met Pastor Bob actually at a local Starbucks near where I live, and he was shooting actually a video for Facebook. And we got talking and have actually known him for a few years, have really enjoyed spending time with him, and am honored to be able to share with you today. One of the things I really like are bookstores. I don't know how many bookstore fans there are out there, but I happen to live close to a Barnes & Noble. And recently, I went into Barnes & Noble's, and what struck me was this one section of books called Personal Growth. And I actually took a photo. So here's a photo that captures just part of this section. And in this section called Personal Growth, here are some of the books that you will find. Change Your Brain, Change Your Life. Creating Your Best Life. Your Fully Charged Life. Stop Missing Your Life. Designing Your Life. Reinventing Your Life. Change Your Thoughts, Change Your Life. Make Your Bed. Little things that can change your life and maybe the world. Best Self, Be You, Only Better. That sounds like something a parent would say to their child. Be You, Only Better. One more, How to Live with Intention. 150 plus simple ways to live each day with meaning and purpose. These are just some of the books in this section. So what does this section at Barnes & Noble tell us about ourselves? What does it reveal about us? That there's something in us that longs for change. That regardless of our religious beliefs, we all have this deep desire for personal change, for personal transformation. That we all look at our lives and see a gap between who we are and who we want to be. Or a gap between who we are and who we were made to be. And we long to bridge this gap. I know I do. That's a huge reason why I'm a follower of Jesus. You know, when I look at this section of the bookstore, I think to myself, well, this is exactly why I follow Jesus. This is what discipleship is all about. Change, transformation, closing the gap between who I am and who I'm made to be. We all want to grow. We all want to change. But the million-dollar question is, how do we do that, right? How do we change? You know, I appreciate these personal growth books. I actually have some of the books that I saw on the shelves there. But are they enough? Is a technique here, a tip there, enough? Can 150 simple ways to live each day with meaning and purpose close this gap? So many of us want to change. So many of us are trying to change, and yet so many of us are stuck. We're stuck in unhealthy habits and addictions. We're stuck in past hurts and emotional pain. We're stuck in dysfunctional patterns and ways of relating. We're stuck. So the question is, how do we change? Now, I believe that Jesus is an expert in helping people change. That's his specialty. So today, I want to lay out a simple framework for how we change. How does change happen according to Jesus? Here's one simple way we can think about it. Teaching plus practice equals change. Not rocket science, right? Teaching plus practice equals change. As John Mark Comer points out, we need both. Not just one, but both. Teaching and practice. And Jesus makes this point in today's scripture. The scripture that is read for us today comes from the very end of Jesus' most famous talk, the Sermon on the Mount. And he finishes this talk by talking about two builders. A wise builder who builds his house on rock, and a foolish builder who builds his house on sand. And Jesus is saying, be the wise builder. Jesus is saying, you know, build your house on a solid foundation. So how do we do that? By doing two things. By hearing Jesus' words and by putting them into practice. That's the key, putting them into practice. And I like the fact that Jesus uses the word practice here. I know for some people that might not be a positive word. But for me, that tells me, you know, practice means we don't get it right the first time. Practice means we're still learning how to do this. Practice means we're going to be learning our entire life how to live out Jesus' teaching. The wise builder hears Jesus' words. That's teaching. And then acts on them. That's practice. And in Luke 8:21, Jesus says, my mother and brothers are those who hear God's word and put it into practice. In John 13:17, Jesus says, now that you know these things, my teaching, you will be blessed if you do them. Put them into practice. Teaching and practice. The two together are how we grow. And so I want to first just say something very briefly about teaching and then focus more on the practice side. Why do we need teaching? Why do we need Jesus' teaching? Because teaching points us in the right direction. Teaching shows us what to aim for. It shows us how to live. Teaching gives us a vision of the good life. Every single one of us has a vision of the good life. And we all learn that vision from something or someone. I mean, we learned it from our parents, or from our friends, or from our heroes, or from our coaches, or from social media. And to follow Jesus means to turn to him and say, I think your vision of the good life is the best one out there, and I want in on it. That's what it means to follow Jesus. It starts with a vision. Jesus is teaching. That's the first step. But a lot of people stop there and wonder why they're not growing. I go to church every week. I even take notes during the sermon. But why aren't I growing? Here's why. As John Mark Comer puts it, Because you can't think your way into Christlikeness. You have to practice your way into it. Following Jesus is a way of life, which means you have to live it. It's not enough to know it. Here's a good thing for us to remember. Knowing something is not the same as doing something, which is still not the same as wanting to do something. Amen? We all know that from reality, right? Knowing something is not the same as doing something, which is still not the same as wanting to do something. In 20 minutes, I could teach you everything Jesus has to say about loving your enemies. Could teach that completely in 20 minutes. You could know it in 20 minutes. But doing that, actually loving your enemies, takes a lifetime. The problem for all of us is that there's a gap between what we know and what we do and what we want to do. In his book, You Are What You Love, James Smith tells the story of reading a book that his wife gave him. And this was a book on the slow food movement, on why it's important to eat locally grown plant-based food. And James Smith was reading this book with gusto. I mean, he was writing in the margins. He was highlighting sections, thinking, I am ready to change my diet. And then he looked up and realized that he was reading this book in the Costco food court while eating a hot dog. Why? Not because he lacked knowledge about healthy eating, but because he loved hot dogs. What we love in our heart influences what we do way more than what we think in our head. I know this from experience, from my experience with Diet Coke. Now, a while back, a good friend of mine was telling me about a coworker who was having all of these problems with her hand. I mean, pain and paralysis in her hand. And then he told me she tried everything, nothing worked, but then she decided to stop drinking Diet Coke. And her hand got better. And my friend was telling me this because he knows I love Diet Coke. And all the while, I was sitting there listening to this thinking, yes, it may cripple me, but I love Diet Coke, so I still drink it. The issue isn't what you know. The issue is what you love. So what do you love? The answer to that question is critical, which is kind of ironic, right? Because in the church, we focus so much on what we know. But what you love is way more important than what you know. And each and every one of us loves things like hot dogs and Diet Coke that are not good for us. So the second million-dollar question is, how do you change what you love? Oof. Through practice. Through practice. Here's why you need teaching plus practice, because what you do shapes what you desire. Your heart follows your habits. Here's a good thing to remember. The things you do do something to you. The things you do something to you. Every daily habit, every weekly routine does something to you. Every daily habit, every weekly routine influences your heart. Our habits shape us. Our habits get into us, not through our heads, but through our hearts. Our habits set the direction of our heart. Our heart follows our habits. Case in point, during the pandemic, I started cycling a lot, riding a bike with these two other guys from the church that I go to. Started riding actually 150 miles a week with them. And here's what was interesting. The more I cycled, the more I wanted to cycle. But lately, over the last several months, my life has gotten much busier, and I've started cycling less. And guess what's happened? The less I cycle, the less I want to cycle. Generally speaking, and I know this is generally speaking, the more you cycle, the more you want to cycle. The more you shop, the more you want to shop. The more you watch YouTube videos, the more you want to watch YouTube videos. The more you gossip, the more you want to gossip. The more you eat French fries, the more you want to eat French fries. The more you pray, the more you want to pray. The more you seek God, the more you want to seek God. Your habits shape your desires. Your habits set the direction of your heart, which is kind of sobering, right? But it's also kind of exciting, because that means you're not powerless. We're not passive in this process. We have a say in it. That's why practicing the way of Jesus is essential. The way we exercise our power is through our practices. Not just thinking about the way of Jesus, but living it. So, how many of you are familiar with the Japanese term dojo? I think a lot of us are, probably through the movie Karate Kid, right? You know, there's these different dojos in that movie. And a dojo literally means place of the way. So it's a school or a practice place to develop a particular skill or discipline like karate. No, but here's the thing. We've made church a lecture hall. But what if we made it a dojo instead? You can't learn karate just by listening and watching. And you can't follow Jesus just by listening and watching. You have to practice. Practice what Jesus taught and did. See, what we need is a Jesus dojo. A space where we can work out the vision and teachings of Jesus in everyday life together. A space where we can practice the way of Jesus, wax on, wax off, so that that way gets into our muscle memory. So that we are living out what Jesus is teaching. Welcome to Messiah Lutheran Dojo. See, this is why I love what Pastor Bob has done on his sabbatical. He decided to walk the Camino, to do a pilgrimage. I would have read books about a pilgrimage, but he walked one, and those are two very different things. Following Jesus is a way of life, which means you have to live it. You have to walk it. And as you do, it's so important to remember that we do not walk it alone. This path of teaching plus practice that leads to change isn't a path that we travel alone. It's a path that we do in community and through the power of the Holy Spirit. See, when we're walking along this path, we stumble. We blow it time and time again. Time and time again, we see that gap between who we are and who we want to be. Yet in that gap, we pick each other up. and cheer each other on. In that gap, Jesus cheers us on. In that gap, Jesus prays for us and breathes his Holy Spirit on us so that God's own presence and power can change us. We're not alone. In that gap, grace finds us. In that gap, grace sustains us. In that gap, grace transforms us so that we can become the people God made us to be. Amen.
We'll continue by reciting our faith, confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. For our love moment today, I want to remind you that Living Vine, our women's Bible study, our large group women's Bible study, is starting their 28th year here at Messiah. This fall, they'll be studying the book of John using study material by Douglas Connolly. They meet on Thursday mornings from 9:15 to 11:15, sharing food, fellowship, music, and a devotion before breaking into small groups for discussion. If you're a woman who could attend on Thursday mornings, you are invited and welcome. You can sign up online. Or if you're here this Sunday, if you're one of those people who likes to watch us online and come on Sunday morning, because I know there are some people who do that, you could also sign up on the patio on Sunday. And as we come to our offering time, this week I was reading in the Psalms, and I came to Psalm 24, which tells us that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell within. We can't buy our salvation, but Scripture reminds us that everything we have really comes from God and encourages us to give back from God what God has provided us as a way of supporting the work of God's kingdom, God's values in the world, and as a way of strengthening our faith, growing in faith, by trusting less in the resources under our control and more on God. Your support of Messiah helps to support many ministries that help us live out the values of the kingdom of God and helps us live out our mission of love God, love one another. As always, you can support our ministry by making a check to Messiah, giving online through your online banking or our website or app, or by texting Messiah YL to the number on the screen. Thanks for your continued generosity and for making a difference as we seek to change lives for the sake of Jesus Christ. Now, please join me in prayer. Almighty God, all that we possess is from your mighty hand. Give us grace so that we may honor you with all that we have, always remembering the account we will one day give to our Lord Jesus Christ. You are our rock, the center of our lives, offering us a covenant of mercy and grace. Keep us in your word. Help us to follow the practices that help us follow you. And strengthen us in our faith and our actions as we seek to follow you. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let's join in the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now let's sing our sending song. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord look upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord with joy. Thanks be to God.